I don't know if it's gonna work, but I found this scorpion. Because what I want to do is get it out, and then maybe I can make it into a graphic. When you do this at home, number one, stay off the drugs. Number two, you need to wear protective eyewear. Because when you want your graphics to be cool, you know, you got to do some things. Oh, Jesus. I thought it would be, like, solid. Oh! Just kidding. Hot day for graphics.
I feel like you look at Dill, and you would go, that guy's probably famous or something.
It's the stinger.
There's something about Dill that makes him unique just by looking at him.
Dill always had the gift of not being on the board and then getting on it and then looking sketchy for a second and then doing the gnarliest thing.
Dill came in and he was like, dude, I'm telling you, this is my last few years on the board. You're gonna wanna have it on film.
He's just so alive and like showman and just fun to talk to and so excited and like that enthusiasm is infectious.
Dill is a talker.
Like, you see these f-ing calves? I will kick the shit out of you.
He's just a fireball. You could tell his brain is just like, this point. I got this to say. Oh, you seen this, blah, blah, blah. Oh, man, I just seen this. This was cool. Like, oh, I was walking down the street, and I seen blah, blah, blah.
I got eyes like a cat. I see everything.
Dill could talk your ear off, but if you listen, you'll learn some good shit.
Yeah, the joke is that you can just probably sit him down in a chair and go like, so, and he'll take it from there.
All right, so, Patrick, Aaron, how long has been doing this?
Need a quick clap.
I love ice cream. Neil Blender. Henry, you're my main man.
Trip out.
What's up? Welcome back to Epically Latered. This new series is on television this time, and we've done tons of episodes. I added them up once, there's maybe 50 of them, and two of those 50 have been on Dill.
What's up?
He was somebody I wanted to revisit. So much has changed in his life. He lives in Los Angeles now.
LA's hectic too, I guess.
He runs a company called FA with Anthony Van Engelen. Real stylish skater. He's also known for his personality. He's kind of like a polarizing, controversial guy.
The world's right now. And everything's so in America. And white people are blowing it, and it's just. Oh.
So we are here at his house in West Hollywood. We're just gonna see what's up with him. So here we are, the Jason Dill episode.
What were you like then? What was going on?
I was just a little white trash kid. Like, that's just shitty. I like just started like liking chicks and like smoking cigarettes with my friends and being bad and listening to Master of Puppets and drawing the cover and shit. When you as a child, 8, 9 years old, come across a skill and people start patting you on the back for it, people start telling you, you better keep doing that because you're really good at it. And you become obsessed with that one thing that you do, you're a weirdo now. For sure, and like you're different now. You're experiencing life differently because you're putting in so many hours of practice into one fixated thing while other kids are, you know, putting toy cars up their butt. You know what I'm saying? Like, you are pattern. Skateboarding's all pattern, and it's like over repetition. It makes you f-ing crazy. Right around like 8, I found myself living across the street from Ed Templeton, and they're skateboarding, and that went from there. And think about it, like, it's crazy. Like, I was seeing Ed Templeton and Jason Lee. Like, they were older dudes, you know? Jerking off and all that shit. They were always talking about shit like that and like chicks and this and that. And like, I remember this one kid, Davis. He was incredible, incredible skateboarder. And I remember, I'm like that age. And he's like, last night I had sex with this girl on mushrooms and her face was melting. And I was like, yes. class. Like, it was just sick education. It was so cool. And then that's when I started to go to contests and I got, like, sponsored. That's when I really started to, like, realize that, like, oh, I'm like an amateur skateboarder. I'm sponsored. This is really cool. I can, like, make something out of this. Being on 101 was, it was definitely my first big deal sponsor. It was not as cop as, not to take anything away from Black Label, but it was 101's a company that turned me pro.
I've heard stories of maybe stealing boards.
That was 19 years old. 19 years old, I lived on my own. I took 36 boards from World and probably a bunch of other product. I sold it so I could pay my rent and shit. It's lame, whatever. I felt like it was lame for they didn't pay me and I needed dough, and then, but at the same time, I took 36 boards, so I totally understand now being older. Like, I don't take it back, but.
We would buy boards from Dill. One time I tried to trade him dirt weed, saying it was like old good shit for some boards, and he was like, yeah, this shit's shit, but you can take those three boards for or whatever. By that time, like, Trilogy had come out, like, I really was like, man, Dill's sick. Like, he was someone I looked up to and ripped.
He's always had flavor. He was like one of those dudes that, like, didn't have that much footage come out, but when he did, it was always sick. It was like he knew just to put out less but make it dope, you know?
It would be like every 401, it would be a gnarly trick of him. I'm like, Deerdick kept hitting him up about like riding for the workshop.
Alien Workshop is and was, you know, the smartest skateboard company ever. Like, I mean, it sounds silly saying that, but if you really think about it, actually, it was the only serious skateboard company.
The quest for the new world order is in part a challenge to keep the dangers of disorder at bay.
1990, when Memory Screen came out, it just shifted my thinking. Everything I saw in that.
This is the Alien Workshop.
From the beginning with the quest for the new world order, all that. You know, when you're a kid and something comes across that you've never even known about, and that's coming in, it's nothing like that. And that's exactly what Memory Screen was. Just like if you were to watch a film at home and you're like, man, that f***ed me up. Skateboarding can do that to you. You can go watch someone's video part. You're like, oh my God, you didn't just do that. And then, like, you see that cocksucker riding away, like, yeah, motherfucker, I did it. It's like murder. It's like legal murder sometimes in a beautiful way. But there's just nothing like the workshop. It just really was, like, in neon lights, just about the best company you could ride for.
Those were, like, the best times of my life, those early Alien years. And, like, I felt like I finally was, like, a part of something that meant something, you know?
1998 to 2000, we made the 401 industry section feedback and photosynthesis. Now, I'm not asking for a f***ing award. I'm just f***ing saying, that's f***ing gnarly.
And you told me that feedback was your like throwaways.
No, I never said that.
Oh, but you said
nothing I've ever put out to throw away. Everything I've ever put out was hard for me to do.
Wrong word.
When we were filming feedback, me and Anthony didn't think Transworld videos were that good. I mean, come on. I'm sorry, Ty, but real quick. I love feedback, but that song f***ing sucks to this day. What the f*** is that song? So we had some Brian Eno song on the European release, then it comes out here and it's like, some f***ing take a ride on a... That f***ing song sucks so bad, but the video part is still okay. And the editing's great. That song, I still can't get over, Ty. I'm sorry, I'm never gonna forgive anyone for that song. See, you gotta love New York. Free bagels.
For sure, when he moved to New York, there was a whole New York Jason, for sure, you know. It all got put together right there.
Yeah. We're on Bowery right now, and I used to live right here, 138. Shit, okay, so it was, it's gone now. Ah, just like everything. I'm sorry, man. It's gone. Early New York, as a teenager, I would basically have to bite my tongue because I was so excited by everything I was seeing. Everything I saw, I was like, oh my God. Like, it was just like, I was so blown away. New York knocked me off my feet and I needed to be there more often. And then once I was, you know, financially capable of being there and not being completely broke, there's nothing like being in your early 20s in New York City, holy shit. This area is Tribeca. You know, it's like the most expensive neighborhood in the world. I lived here, yep. But I had to live with a parrot named Walter, and he's a asshole. Walter was such a dick. I hated Walter. He was the meanest parrot you ever could have met. I used to walk around these streets at such a young age, just flying high, you know what I mean? Like, I didn't really think. I just would get f***ed up and just...
I think at that time, there was a lot of, like, partying and shit going on and, like, meeting a lot of, like, different people even outside of skate and stuff. Like, I mean, he's always Dill, but, you know, extra New York party Dill.
I think the scene at the time when I first moved here and Dill was here, I think that scene was just so powerful. And it felt like, dang, there's a whole world out here that I didn't know, meeting all these different people that have nothing to do with skating. And we were just going out every single night and just having the best nights of our lives, really. There was like 30 of us at every party, every night. Like, you know, it was crazy. It was like a web of craziness.
I would go stay at Dill's and when they lived on Broadway and Canal. And I remember one time he had like board shorts and like penny loafers. And he was just telling me how I'm never doing cocaine again. Like, that shit's gross. I hate people who are doing cocaine. And literally 5 minutes later, he comes out of the bathroom. He's like, I just snorted a bunch of coke. He's wearing penny loafers and trunks. And I was just like, man, you are
I'm about to do whatever the hell I goddamn please.
I don't remember if he said it or I said it, but someone was like, do you like to do drugs? And I was like, yeah. And then we went on this like 17-day bender. We just did whatever we wanted. It's insane that we're alive.
That time period from 1998 to 2003 was just mayhem.
They took so much volume on a flight here that it's taking its toll on me.
Finally, money started coming in. It was like, holy shit. It was like, I'm buying a pair of Jordans every day. I have my own bags of cocaine. It's not someone else's bag of cocaine I'm borrowing to go to the bathroom with. It's like, you know what I mean? Like, and then like you meet all these people who do not skateboard.
Let's get crazy, let's get nuts.
Let's do it.
That's why I like New York. You know, I like that shit where like, you could be in the mix of something. You never really knew what everyone did. I really liked that. I thought that was cool.
It's a new era. New era in skateboarding, and I have to say it's a new era in life. Things have changed.
See?
We're on Canal Street, and we're coming up on Broadway, and that's where I lived for a long time, like all 9/11, I lived here. So on 9/11, but I woke up hearing my roommate say, what do you mean a plane flew into the World Trade Center? Like, because he was on the phone, our walls were super thin.
And I just put my pants on. I was like, I need to see it. But I thought it'd be like a little plane. Like, once I turned the corner, I saw both buildings on fire. The closer you would get walking down, you'd see people start walking toward you covered in white soot. From here, at first you thought it was just debris, like falling. Like, a lot was debris. But then once you get close enough and you could, like, it's like, you know, oh my God, that's a man and a woman jumping. Like, he's wearing a blue suit, and like, you could start to see, like, you know, like, it really, actually, hold on.
I knew it was gonna happen. Thank you.
That's right, I'm the best, totally. By the time that I walked back down and I ran into my roommate and my girlfriend, you know, that's when he was like, turn around. And I just, that was that. We didn't do that photo to like, out of disrespect or anything like that. It was so insane. You know what I mean? I don't know. I don't talk about this shit too much because it's like, you know, it's real f***ed up, man.
Real life? TV.
You'll never see something so psycho. You know what I mean? Like, you hope not to.
What's happening with your video part, buddy?
I'm gonna tell you this one more time. I want this video part so bad. I want it to be so good.
No, you call me more often than not sure what day of the week it is.
Carter, it is Friday the 10th.
I'm just telling you, Dill, my observations, and I'm worried about you.
I know, Carter, but it's gonna have a, I think it's more me being more flamboyantly, extravagantly, I don't know, maybe I am that f***ed up.
Skateboarding needs personality. And you need dudes like him, you know? Everything that I like about skateboarding, he's like, fit that, you know what I mean? There was something about him that was magnetizing, for me at least, and I think a lot of other people too. I think when his photosynthesis part came out, I think everyone was like, dude, this part is f***ing sick.
Filming for photosynthesis with Bill was the best. It was so great because photosynthesis just happened. We would just go out and skate. We'd get tricks or we wouldn't. And then at night we'd go get f***ed up. It was great. There was no, oh, you need a last trick or like, you know, you need another line or none of that. It all just came together.
It wasn't like a job really. We'd just be out, like, having fun all the time, and then it'd be like, dude, deadlines in 2 months. I'm like, dude, we gotta get it together. Like, let's go and skate. And I'd be like, all right. He would just try shit and get it done.
I knew I wasn't gonna make a better video part. And that's tough when you're in your early 20s and you don't wanna peak, you know, too soon. Photosynthesis was the last video that it just came out and it didn't feel like work. Everything else after that felt like a lot of work.
My mother shit every night is about drinking.
The time on the board was getting further apart. Tricks landed, film. It was the beginning of the worst of the worst.
Tempo, cruise tempo, cruise tempo, cruise tempo.
He would show up on trips and I could tell like he just ain't been skating, partying.
$20 to open the restaurant. To get me cigarettes, I'll give you $50. You all.
It's close.
$50.
But then, like, you'd be a few days in the trip, and he's f***ing ripping. you know, and he's getting shit, and you're just like, what the f***? Like, I've never seen you do that trick.
I'm not ashamed of the minefield, but I most certainly got by on the skin of my teeth with that part, and I really owe Greg Hunt an apology for just being so...
I mean, I would say minefield was probably a challenging time for Dill. He was still kind of, like, drinking a lot and stuff, so he wasn't, I would say, like, in tip-top shape. He would kind of not skate for a while, and then you'd come on a trip and try to skate, and you'd sometimes get hurt. Like his wrist, I think he broke his wrist a couple times.
Yeah, I was a mess during minefield. I was a f***ing mess.
It's still good, though. That's the thing about Jason. It's like, it's still out of that video. Like one of the parts that I would watch, you know what I mean? And that I like. So he has that, you know, whether his effort level is at 20% or 100, you know, people want to see it.
Between 2006 and 2009, I probably developed my worst drug addiction.
Yeah, what kind of drugs are we talking about?
I'd smoke speed, I'd smoke crack, I'd take pills, I'd do whatever you got. But the main thing that would keep me kind of like buzzing throughout my days was Vicodin and Percocets mixed with booze. And it would get larger in quantity as you went on, and the years you go on, you do more and all that bullshit.
You know, I wasn't talking to him very much, and he had that morning where he woke up throwing up blood and shit.
It was Jameson and Vicodin, and that caused a hole in my belly, and I woke up one morning and I threw up blood everywhere. And I ended up at a New York downtown hospital for a bit, and they were like, you had a gastric hemorrhage. Your insides kind of look like a 60-year-old bum's. You gotta cut this shit out, you're gonna die.
He ended up in L.A., and I was living in Venice at the time, and then he stayed in this, like, weird motel in Santa Monica, and I'd pick him up. Man, he looked like shit. He was, like, grayish yellow. He wasn't good, you know? And whatever, long story short, ended up staying with me for a year and getting his shit together and skating a lot. We ate, slept, breathed skateboarding. That's all we did. We'd come home, watch videos, fall asleep on the couch, like, get up, go skate. We skated every single day for like a year. That's when he really got his shit together, you know? Like, it's all the times I've spent with Dill, that was the most epic of times, and it was rad.
...2013 came flying in, and I quit Alien Workshop after 15 years to do F.A. I think I was in London, and I was drunk in the back of a taxi cab, and I was with my now partner, Mikey Piscitelli. And I said, I want to make a clothing company. I want to call it awesome. And he was like, wow, that's dumb. And I was like, yep. And then he went back to America, and I remember calling him from a payphone. And I was like, what are you doing? He's like, I'm trying to make this logo for you.
From 2000 to 2005, we were making shirts pretty sporadically. And I mean, small amounts, like 300 of something. And only selling it to Supreme in New York and Japan. I'd say the first three rounds of shirts, they were all printed by us in our apartment. But 2005, we had like a big spike in popularity in that streetwear world, and it got a little too big where it wasn't manageable between everything else we had going on, so we just didn't do anything for a year, when I think most people would have jumped at that. doing it that way allowed us to not fall into any trends or die. And because we never did it as a source of income, it stayed pure where we were able to do whatever we wanted, to the point when Dill and Abe decided that they were gonna leave Workshop. Dill's like, I wanna turn the FA into a board company.
Yeah, there you go.
At that time, we were just so sick of, across the board with skate companies, like everything got so soft and watered down because there was so much money and everything got built up and like, you know, there's these huge infrastructures for these companies that, you know, we have to make product that sells to Zoomies because we have to. We want that stuff we came from. And we still thought that there was skaters out there that weren't jocks. And like, we're attracted to skateboarding for the same reasons we were and needed that.
Skateboarding sold itself to the mall. You just can't contain a whole culture of a thing inside of your Spencer's Gifts.
We already had an idea of team riders and like it was all right there, but it was a gnarly idea of leaving the workshop after 14, 15 years.
There was definitely a time when I was like, guys, I don't know. I'm f***ing scared. And Bill and Anthony stayed on me. They really, really stayed on me. We quit May 1st, 2013. No bullshit, man. That was gnarly. It was sad.
That was so hard for him. And I think that also added to the fear of everything, of like, I'm leaving this place I'd always been, and I'm gonna do my own thing, which is awesome. But then with that, there was a lot of weight that I think he felt he had to carry on his own. Yeah, he was crazy for a while.
Stuff. It's all a mess. Believe it or not, this is all unused material. Most all of it's been scanned, but FA graphics, like everything that ends up being something for sale, comes from here. Like, it comes from this area. I just like anything that's physical. I like that you can cut things and like rearrange them. At least the idea is there.
He got a very clear idea of what he thought was cool in skateboarding. And the clearer that idea got, the more fixated he got on separating himself from everyone else. Basically what I mean is he's got a clear understanding for what he thinks is cool and what he thinks sucks. And right now in skateboarding, what he thinks is cool is it's the most popular things out, you know? So I think that his genius was on par for the timing of where popular culture is at and where skateboarding's at.
One big thing I really enjoy about owning my own company, I no longer have to answer the question of what do you do for a living with? Oh, professional skateboarder. Because it just sounds like, I might as well say, like, I'm a professional pogo stick, you know? Now I can be like, oh, I'm a company owner.
Oh, really? Well, is there a lucrative business? Well, yeah, Poindexter, actually it is. I'm doing pretty good owning a skateboard company. But you know what I mean? I no longer have to be like, pro skateboard, blah, blah, blah. And then people are like, oh, you want ESPN? You do the X Games? It's like, no. Do you know Tony Hawk? Ding, I do. And that's the one question, you know, like, I know Tony. Yeah, he's a good guy. I love Tony Hawk.
I just want to show it this because if anyone's ever seen one of these episodes that Patrick's done with me before, I never had a kitchen that looked like this.
That episode begins with like a blood spit on the wall?
Yeah.
Did you fix your teeth?
Yeah. For the most part, I mean, we're looking at about $18,000 later.
Even back then, when he was in New York, he would always have stuff hanging up in his apartments and stuff, like photos that he had cut together, little collages, just random gnarly Polaroids of like somebody all bloody, like him naked, weird stuff just hanging up all over. And the FA graphics look a lot like the stuff he just had hanging up in his apartment.
There's a whole room in my house I won't let you see, because it all looks like this. No one goes in there, it's just me. I've basically accumulated my own thrift store back there. So.
Why can't we go in?
It's too much. It's too crazy right now because I feel so good about how together I now appear compared to when I was on this thing when I was younger. It's funny. If you make everything at home, you're stuck at home and you're making everything within your patterns, all your views and all your weird opinions and everything to you that you're making to show the general public whatever point of view this is or this has, whatever this says. But you know everybody's gonna be judging it, and it's like, I judge every skateboard company when they up. I think a lot of people in the industry make my job easy. But then it's not easy, it's tough. If I don't make the boards, there's no boards. If I don't make the shirts, there's no shirts. You have to come up with an idea every day, kind of. I don't know what I'm doing. I have it done from a month-by-month basis. I'm only doing whatever I'm doing in the moment that feels right, like whether it be doing ads a certain way or making a video come out a certain way or doing, I can only base it on right now.
Dill's got an eye for what's good, and he won't let anyone else do it, you know? So he's the one that's just sitting there doing it. That's what keeps him in the mix. But he's, you know, he's constantly looking at everything like, oh, like, I see what Kevin's doing. Like oh, I want to kind of try to incorporate something like that for his graphic, you know?
Everybody tells me all the time, like, FA has the best graphics, and it's, I don't even put stickers on my boards. You see, if you can't tell.
I always was like, damn, I'm gonna get my first pro graphic tattooed on my arm right here. And then my first pro graphic was a picture of my face as a child. And I was like, I'm not about to get that.
They're all great, man. Like, Knuckles. Kevin Bradley's. Kush Cowboy. Got his weed diploma. Sages.
Look at this.
Original Clo board.
Why did you want to give her a board?
Because Chloe rules. She just is great. Like, Chloe's just the best. She's just, you know, it's like that Stevie Nicks, super sick, like, you can't let me put your finger on it, but it's the business.
You're a pro skater?
I know, I'm a pro skater. I have a pro deck. I have to thank him for, like, keeping me relevant in a way with the young kids, you know? And I'm pretty grateful that he did that, you know?
I remember skating this board and it was so good. Like, I got like a lot of good clips on this board that I really liked. This is Dylan board that I skated. It's one of my favorite boards. This is a painting, it's not a photo. And it's so insane. Dylan's kid picture. I used to have the painting of this. I wanted to do a board that's really special for Dylan when he got sick. And so I got with his artist, Delphin, who's really great. And I said, I want modern Dylan clothes on a child Dylan. We got photos from Dylan's mom, and I said, let's do this one and put it on like a leather jacket with a button-up shirt. And he did it, and it came out really great. Dylan was so special. Just one of the greatest ever. We put him on Alien when he was young. So he was on Alien with us. As we went along, like, Dylan would come to New York and, like, visit me and, like, hang out, and Bill, and, like, he kind of became kind of known, you know, like, coming out to New York and just kicking ass. It's damned if you don't, it's damned if you don't. Be true, cause I'll lock you up in the sets shit was insane to watch in person, man. He just, like, just to level up so hard. It's like the best of the best. The response after Dylan passed away was like, it was It's really, really beautiful. It was just like, I'm so glad that we were able to do what we were able to do. With Dylan, the amount of time that he was alive, I mean, I got to go on so many tours with him. I got to see like him like blossom. I remember he had no tattoos and you know, all that shit, like all that stuff that you like see someone going from like a kid into a man and all that stuff, you know? So I really appreciate that, it's great. His ashes are right there. Like, I have some of his ashes and Bill has some and yeah, no, his mom gave them to us and I keep that little picture there and the little, I love that picture of me and Dylan. But yeah, Super Dylan, he's the best.
So we're supposed to meet Jason Dill here, and he got arrested on the way here for a joint. Got arrested. I'll be there by 12:30 or 1. I thought getting arrested takes longer than that.
We're passing by the Bowery Mission, whatever that is, and he didn't get a chance to tell me what that was because the police came up out of nowhere. He wasn't even smoking because he was telling me about all this shit. Like, so the shit had went out already. So he was like, yeah, blah, blah, blah. Next thing you know, police came and grabbed him. Free deal. You locked up. I didn't even get a chance to hit it like that. Like, that's not why I'm bummed. I mean, it sucks that Dill's locked up. Like, he'll get out. The joint is gone, for sure. That shit's never coming back. Free the joint, really.
The cool thing about awesome and seeing sort of it as being this kind of little personal thing that Dill did for so long, and now what it is, this huge board company with this massive team. And I think more than anything, it stokes me out to see that he has such a solid group of young kids on his team who he really like loves and respects. A lot of these kids have known each other for a long time. They've known Dill for a long time. And now these kids are just so good, and now they're influencing a whole generation. It's really cool to see what it's become.
Hey, free Dill.
Free Dill.
Up, man. I'm up, man. Yeah.
Like, of anything to get back for, it's such bullshit, man. I'm sorry to be so late. How about this for a shot? I love these guys. These guys are my best friends.
When I got the chance to do the video for Supreme, Cherry, I was so psyched. Just like kind of like felt like the time. Like I felt the energy and no one knew the footage I had. So I was kind of just trying to tell Dill like, dude, you gotta do something with these kids right now. I'm like, just trust me.
Respect the youth. The youth are getting restless. I've always called them my kids because people kind of refer to them. They'd be like, oh, I seen your kids. And like, I used to give Sage Alien Workshop, like, you know, a lot of them would get boards from me. And then, you know, you gotta understand, when they were filming Cherry, Tyshawn was 13. I think a lot of people in the skateboard industry thought I was tripping. Look at them now. You know what I mean? Like, no one can touch them. They're the best.
Dill's really good with people and like, and he's been through a ton of shit, so, and a lot of these kids too, like, they're going through shit, so he has that type of relationship with them too.
You know, you drop out of school, smoke the pot, take the acid, go pro one day. How about that? America. This is America. Get used to it, white people. F you.
He'll also get on their ass about shit too.
Well, I have a word to say to you too. Jesus. You better behave these days. If you do some shit that he don't like, he gonna say how he feel. Period. You gotta respect that. Dill is very passionate. And that's what happens when you have passion. You know, a lot of people in the industry are just fake as f***.
He's someone that they look up to. He's not perfect, and he doesn't claim to be. Well, maybe he claims to be a little bit. But at the same time, he's such a, like, good person to be learning from, because he's been through it.
Does he ever give you like fatherly advice?
Oh my, like all the time, man.
Does he ever take on a role like a sort of like
father? No.
He say that shit, but that nigga ain't my father. My father name is Tyshawn Jones. That ain't my father. That's my big homie. That ain't my dad.
The best one is when I was skating with Alex Olsen, and I was like arguing with this guy who had parked his car on the way, and I was like, yo, get out of here. But little did I know that by doing that, I was making the whole process just take longer, you know? So word got back to Dill that I was being annoying on the session. And Dill was like, when you go skate with those dudes, you're a ghost. You sit in the corner and you watch. I'm like, hell yeah. All right.
What was filming that?
Good skate etiquette, though. I feel it. You
Dill
just sit
is
there.
So dramatic.
Yeah.
Dill is a drama queen.
You gotta
he's
like
a,
this.
He's a master of theater.
Dill showed me more of the art in the other stuff around skateboarding, and even the art in skateboarding, like telling me things like nobody should ever have bad flat ground. Like, if you have bad flat ground, you're a trash skater.
I always say, like, I love them all so much, and all together they make my favorite skater, you know what I mean? I'm at awe of it all the time. Like, I can't believe it. This is so cool to see them go from where they are to now. It's like, you couldn't ask for anything cooler than that.
I'm so proud of them. They're the new pros. And I couldn't be happier with, like, who they are, what they are, what this is, what we've done. It's great. What I really like now is how they'll go to different countries on tours for shoe companies that they have contracts with, whatever. And they'll stay for like another month and shit. I'm like, that's what I did. And like, just like eating in nice restaurants where they never thought they were gonna eat at, and just getting high all around the planet and just landing it and ripping and living. That's all I wanted out of this whole shit. Everything that happened outside of my drug use. I wanted these kids to experience the professional skateboarding experience that I got to experience, which was psycho and beautiful and scary and dangerous. And I don't understand how I made it to be sitting in this chair now, because it was really insane.
Ha ha ha!